The equity rally posed treasuries take a breather as investors are fully focused on Biden and EU leaders meeting today and what kind of new sanctions that could come out of it, including the possibility of a ban on Russian oil imports to Europe. Now, some Russian stocks start trading today, but the action will be limited as you can't just go and sell or short sell the Russian company stocks for now. So welcome, this is Swissquote's Daily Market Talk. Now, market is volatile and the risk appetite is not strong as Joe Biden will meet the EU leaders today and they are expected to announce new sanctions against Russia in the coming hours. So there is a possibility of a ban on Russian oil imports to Europe as one of the biggest worries, which was to lose the gas flow along with it, while 40% of Europe's gas comes from Russia, has been partially eased as Qatar agreed recently to supply gas to Europe. But the solution is a long-term solution and weaning from the Russian oil won't be immediate, unfortunately. So Germany and Hungary are not necessarily in for a Russian energy ban. But in reality, that's the step that needs to be taken if Europe wants Russia to maybe, but just maybe, ease the intensity of its attack on Ukraine. So the geopolitical uncertainties and the uncertainties about the Russian oil keeps investors betting in all directions right now, but the oil bulls have the upper hand and the barrel of US crude consolidates a touch above the 115 per barrel mark this morning, and the positive pressure is here to stay until there is more clarity regarding the new sanctions against Russia. Now, if Europe decides to walk away from the Russian oil and maybe gas, we will certainly see another leg up in oil prices, although a part of such risk is certainly already priced in. And if not, well, we shall see oil return toward the $100 per barrel level. Yet, the tight supply and rising demand in oil markets globally will certainly throw a floor under any short-term price pullback. So the 50-day moving average is, for now, the major support to the actual rally in oil and stands a touch below the $98 per barrel mark presently. Now, the Russian market partially opens today after being shut for a month, but only 33 Russian company shares will be allowed to trade for a shortened 4-hour trading session if the trading doesn't stop due to a move in MOEX about 15% within 10 minutes or 20% for the individual stock. So the Russian companies that will start trading today include the big guys such as Gazprom or Sberbank, for example, which actually lost big since Russia invaded Ukraine a month ago, and foreigners won't be allowed to sell their stake until April 1st, and well, short selling will be banned as well, meaning that investors will only be allowed to sell whatever shares they had bought in the past from April 1st and won't be allowed to borrow and sell these stocks to bet for a price decline in these companies' valuations, which actually could take a very, very severe toll in the coming weeks as Russia has been cut from the Western economies, remember, as a result of the invasion of Ukraine. And because most of the Russian market was made up of international investors, we will not get a clear picture of these company valuations immediately because they just can't sell, but they want to sell. So I could catch the first minutes of trading in Moscow just before, and we even saw gains in MOEX, but again, the trading is extremely, extremely limited and we won't have a clear settlement in valuations before investors will be allowed to sell their stocks because they probably want to sell their stocks. Oh, and Russia has a budget to support the price action, which should also temper the first day volatility, yet the medium-term outlook for Russian stocks is obviously not brilliant at all. In fact, Gazprom and Sberbank lost more than 99% of their value in London trading after the invasion began and, well, stopped trading right after. So it gives us an idea of the severity of the decline we shall see in these Russian stocks in the coming days and weeks. Oh, and last but not least, about Russia. Putin now wants its clients to pay the natural gas purchases in rubles in an attempt to support the falling ruble and to reduce the risk of holding foreign currencies as sanctions become heavier to stand. We can't really, you know, criticize him for doing this. While dollar ruble is back below the 100 mark after having come closer to 140 level in the first days of the Ukraine invasion, the latest move could actually help throw a floor under the ruble's short-term depreciation, as it will obviously increased demand in rubles significantly. In fact, Europeans pay $285 million every day to buy the Russian oil alone. So if Europeans decided to walk away from the Russian oil, well, the impact of the latest measure will be lessened. But it's obviously all a question of how far both parties are willing to go in terms of using their economic or military power in something that has already become a world war, in my opinion. Even though the US and the Europeans are not in Ukraine physically with their arms, well, they are very, very much involved in this Ukrainian conflict, at least economically for now. So with these escalating tensions into today's Europe-Biden meeting, the dollar firmed against major peers yesterday. The euro-dollar slipped below the 1.10 mark again, as European addiction of Russian oil could cost the continent a lot in terms of inflation and economic growth. Goldman Sachs revised its forecast for euro area GDP growth to 2.5% in 2022 from 3.9% previously, and that takes into account the sharp rise in energy costs and potential supply disruptions, which will also force the European Central Bank's hand to get more aggressively hawkish on its policy to avoid an overheating inflation in the eurozone, as inflation at the current levels could no longer be ignored by policymakers. So is it possible for the latest rally to pose after indices recovered all losses made since the beginning of the war in Europe? Well, it is to be seen. Today, the early mood is not so bad, but the winds could rapidly change direction in the actual environment of high geopolitical uncertainties. But for now, investors don't have the courage to buy the DAX past the 14,500 mark. And the EU is also expected to unveil new legislation as soon as today, maybe, to curb the market power of big companies that are worth at least 75 billion euros and that run one core platform service and have 45,000 active users. So obviously, the US giants like Google or Amazon are obviously the main target of the legislation. But there are some European companies, such as the Dutch Booking.com, that could also feel the pinch of the new European rules, along with the prospects of rising inflation in Europe and tighter monetary policies and war and etc. So what do investors do in surging inflation environment like today's? Well, Mohammed El Ryan advises cutting equity exposures due to the mounting risk of stagflation. So stagflation is the combination of high inflation and slow growth, or high unemployment, which is pretty much the same thing because it just would come along with slow growth. UBS likes hedging portfolios with energy and commodity stocks, as you know, while BNP says shorting the 10-year treasury futures could actually be a good hedge against soaring inflation, given that the rising inflation will boost the Fed tightening, which will at some point involve balance sheet reduction as well, and a higher downside pressure on treasuries, obviously. So speaking of treasuries, we actually saw yesterday a much needed easing or relief in the treasury sell-off, though the outlook for treasuries remains obviously and comfortably bearish, which means that the yields should keep rising in the US. Gold, on the other hand, tests the $1,950 offers this morning, and there is potential for further advance in gold as uncertainties loom and the market lacks a clear direction right now, or lacks a clear explanation also of why the equities bounced back so sharply in the past couple of days. I believe there is still the possibility of a rebound in the yellow metal toward the $2,000 mark. The steep rise in US yields is, of course, a turnoff for investors in the absence of clear loss of appetite. But if things are to get uglier, well, gold is obviously a good refuge for investors looking for refuge. So this is all for today. I'm Ipekos Kardeşkaya and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and it has been insightful to you. So please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions and your questions below and follow us on Instagram, on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates and subscribe, of course, to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow and until then, good day trading.